Welcome, everyone. Welcome, members. Welcome, guests. We're ready to start with our terrific show. I'm Ann Mason, and I'm a member of the Program Committee for the National Railway Historical Society's DC chapter. And tonight, I'm sitting in for vacationing Scarlet Work. The DCNRHS is the Washington chapter of the National Railway Historical Society, and our chapter's mission is to extend the public appreciation of railroads and their history through preservation and education. We accomplish this mission through a variety of programs, including we sponsor a scholarship to rail camp for a high school student. We operate three rail cars, including two end cars and our beloved 1923 Pullman car, the Dover Harbor. We maintain a railroad library at Bowie Tower in Maryland, and we publish our monthly newsletter, The Timetable. Another way we fulfill our mission is by offering free public programs, including tonight's event. Our program tonight is the Agony and Ecstasy of Private Car Ownership, and we are featuring our very own Renee Lubke. Renee is trained as a civil engineer and works for the Patent Office reviewing engineering materials. But tonight, she's going to be talking about her experiences as a private car owner. Back in the mid-80s, a number of friends bought an open platform coach. The leading participant in that group was in Renee's wedding party. But on the day of the wedding, the car was derailed in Pennsylvania, and he almost didn't make the wedding. This misfortune did not curtail the friendship nor the enthusiasm of the group to own a private car. So in 1987, the four partners established Classic Rail Cars and purchased another rail car, a retired Norfolk and Western business car. So there's lots more to this fascinating tale and in subsequent years of preservation and renovation. So let's now go to the main event and turn the meeting over to Renee and hear the rest of the story about how she and her partners became owners of private cars. And in the process, she will pull back the curtain to reveal the joys and the challenges of private car ownership. So if you've ever toyed around with the idea of being a private car owner, get ready to put your questions into the chat, and let's welcome Renee to the platform.
Thank you, Ann. The agony and ecstasy of private rail car ownership is something that one should not do alone. I did not do this alone. I did this with a cast of characters. So this, I would like to introduce you to them. I'm going to go backwards from right to left. On the right is Ken Bitten and his now wife, Ren Bitten. I'm in the middle there. My late husband, Kevin Lipke, is next to me. And the four of us formed Classic Rail Cars that Ann referred to back in 1987. It was something that we did not on the spur of the moment, certainly. We'd been looking at other cars and dealing with other people's cars, including the one that got derailed. That was a car called the Mucina, which was an awesome car with a very deep open platform and open sections. It would have been a great car for running, operating, traveling cross country or short party trips. But to this day, the original owners, when I was working on it, are not around anymore. They've sold it. But to this day, that car has never been operated on Amtrak. The fifth gentleman in this picture on the left is the late Don Smith, and he became our partner because he was the majority, I won't say partner, he became associated with us because he was the majority owner of a sleeping car. And as we'll see, it's nice to have a variety of different cars when you're operating. We are standing on the platform of Blue Ridge, our premier car, our first car, and the one we were best known for. The car to the right is Lehigh Valley 353. At the time this picture was taken in 1989, That car was owned by a gentleman named Dick Horstman, who was very well known in the private car business. The car now, I believe, is at Steamtown. He donated it before he passed away. The big picture there is the Messina. It was a basket case, although I have seen worse when it was purchased and brought to Pennsylvania. I suppose that is why it derailed. In fact, Anne reminded me of that derailment story, and I had to go back to the magazine that she read it in and look at it myself because I had forgotten that and the part that my wedding played, or that it played in my wedding day. Yes, owning a private car can get in the way of all sorts of things, but this is how it starts, working like crazy. That's me up on the roof. That is Mr. Bitten. That's Ken on the roof on the other side. And Yacina, for those who care about these things, was an ex-CSX car. It had a lot of rough service. Its last service was in work train service. So you can imagine it was rather beat up. But if you look on the right end of it, you can see that it's got that very deep double platform, and it's an awesome car, and it's too bad it never ran for fun in private ownership. We got started in private cars riding other people's private cars, as hopefully most people do. Some of the strangest telephone calls I get, in fact, or emails later on, had to do with people who didn't get involved in organizations and didn't know what they were wanting to get into, and they'd ask me how they buy a car. And I'd say, what do you know about it? And they'd tell me nothing. At least these three organizations. APRCO is the American Association of Private Railcar Owners. They early on had a reputation of lots of rich folks who paid other people to work on their cars. But despite that, even if you pay someone else to work on your car, you need to know about it. And they offered good seminars, and a lot of people knew what they were talking about. And it definitely pays to listen. Rail Passenger Car Alliance is another group that is a lot of fun to belong to. Besides incredibly knowledgeable people involved in that, one of the members there who I've learned a lot from was actually involved in helping the Smithsonian bring in railroad cars for two of their exhibits. The first one at the Holocaust Museum. And it's full of people who know all sorts of things about private cars. The people who inspect cars like the Dover Harbor are members of RPCA. And I won't say last but not least, because historic society chapters like the DCNRHS are also very important, especially when they own equipment. And so it was through talking to people in these organizations that I learned a lot. Or I shouldn't say talking to, listening to people in these organizations is how I learned a lot about private cars. The mechanical side of it from RPCA mostly, the operational side of it from APRCO. One of the first seminars I attended at an APRCO convention had to do with dealing with Amtrak and how to move your car on Amtrak. When we started, by the way, this will refer to a lot of things. When we started, there was like no internet. You could email, but that was about it. And so to run a car on Amtrak, you had to fill out a form in like triplicate or quadruplicate. That was my job because I lived here. Usually the form went in the mail, but I could walk it over to Amtrak at Union Station. I also physically walked over to the Alexandria Station and bought tickets. Got to know some folks there too. Got to know one of the ticket sellers there so well that about 5 to 10 years after we stopped running, I was in Richmond, and I went into the train station in Richmond, and the ticket seller was there because he was a native Richmonder, and he recognized me.
So Renee, when you joined these trade organizations for private rail cars. Were you a car owner at the time, or because you were part of working with your other partner, were you participating in that way, or how did you get involved with these two organizations?
RPCA, I was recommended to by others. That was the third organization of the three I joined, but it was only probably a few months later. I joined for one of their conferences, and their conferences are always in January. We went through a lot of consideration, although not as much as you might think, about what we were going to buy. This is the Blue Ridge that we ended up with. And as it turns out, it was in very good condition. So while we kind of thought we'd be doing a lot of renovation on a car, we ended up with a car that was almost ready to run right away. So we had to get up to speed on that side of it really quick. That's where Apricot came in. But one of the things that we did do with the car before it was on about the time it was on Amtrak. I hate to bring up this subject, but NRHS had its national convention in New Jersey back in the late 1980s. And we were one of the private cars there. One of the other private cars there had a very, very experienced operator. His name is Jim Fetcherow. And in the off time, since we were both living on our cars there, we got to talking. And so he got me interested or knowledgeable about some of the other organizations and other people. But it's just everything you do builds on what you knew. My first experience actually with a private car, I didn't even know was a private car. My first roommate was a legislative aide to a senator here. One of the issues she covered was transportation. The legislative aides used to do all sorts of extra things with industry. And some Saturday, she was supposed to take a trip on a train. Her work associate couldn't make it. And she's like, Renee, come on along. And it was a CSX train, and they were trying to impress Congress. And there were a whole bunch of legislative aides on it. One of the cars on that train was the Eagle Canyon, which still runs in West Virginia, I believe. And it had a book full of pictures of what it took to restore that car. And that got me interested also. And mentioned my background. Besides being generally interested in transportation and big things, civil engineers tend to like big things, I've also done archaeology work. Working in private railroad cars, especially like the museum and the older ones that need restoring, it's a bit like industrial archaeology. But there's a whole lot of different parts to owning and operating a car. When you're an NRHS chapter and have it over harbor, you've got 300 members to draw skills from. Classic rail cars was four people. Fortunately, we have a variety of skills. My background is technical. Ken's is business. My husband was very mechanical. John Eldridge has heard of or knows my husband because he was a submariner. Kevin went from operating submarines, particularly the nuclear power plant, to keeping private railroad cars happy, including little quote unquote air conditioners and generators. Three out of the four of us were more than capable in the kitchen, but we knew enough to hire professional chefs for most of our trips. We also did call upon a few other people besides professional chefs. The floor plan in that drawing in this slide was done by my brother, who's an architect. Have to give credit where credit is due. About the car that we ended up with, after looking at other people's cars and seeing other people's cars and riding a few, was indeed a business car. We bought it from Norfolk Southern. Back then, pre-internet, you didn't go online and see who was selling cars. There are a small number, but they're out there right now where you can go online and see what cars are for sale. And there are quite a few. If anyone wants to buy one, I'm willing to offer a hand. I don't formally do appraisals, but I can help you in that direction. But back then, you wrote letters to railroads, you used your connections in those organizations, and in fact, Norfolk Southern was selling a bunch of cars about the time we were interested in buying. And they were announced by mail. We had inquired by telephone and mail initially. We put in our bid by mail, I believe, pretty sure. But before we put in a bid for a car of this caliber, we went down to see it. The car was located in Roanoke. It's an XNW car. It was built as a diner in 1914. It was converted to a business car with a somewhat unusual floor plan, I understand, in the 30s, and converted to the floor plan that it was that you see here in the 50s. Who went down to Roanoke to look at this? The two ladies in the group, of course. Ren and I went down to Roanoke with a tape recorder and a camera in hand. We had looked over the auction list, and there were three cars, I believe, that we were mostly interested in. And so we asked a lot of questions, an awful lot of questions, took a few notes, not too many in writing, because we had the tape recorder, and took some pictures. Well, the best laid plans, because that tape recorder malfunctioned, and the pictures that I took, lo and behold, one of the few roles I ever had that got messed up by the developer. Boy, do I like new cameras and cell phones that have cameras these days. But anyway, we came back and talked to Kevin and Ken about the cars, and we did indeed put a bid in on this car, and I think the other two also. One of the other cars that was sold in that auction is a car that looks a lot like this one. It was called the Ocean, or it became, I forgot what it was originally called by NS, but it became a car called the Ocean when it went into private ownership. The other one was a theater car with a rear end that was all glass. Kind of an interesting car, and if I had known what would have happened these days where Amtrak won't let you ride on a platform, maybe we would have tried harder to get that one. if I recall, and if someone does wants to tell me otherwise, it went by the name of, I think, Alta Vista, and I believe it's with a short line in Tennessee now, but that could have changed.
So when you went down there, you and Ren, did you have a list of criteria as a technical person? Did you say, okay, I want a car that has so many bedrooms or so many working features, or how did you actually narrow it down to three?
Well, we had looked through the bid list and looked at what was available from them and thought that these would be interesting. We had discussed what we would like to do with the car before we started bidding. And that was run mostly one car at a time, public trips out of New York City. Why New York City, you ask? I live here in the Washington area. Ken and Ren live north of Baltimore. Well, I've known Ken since junior high school. Ken and I are both from northern New Jersey. We still have connections up there. We also know people and know the attitudes of people up there. The bottom line is, in New York, they work hard and play hard. In Washington, they're just a bunch of workaholics. Also, we found a friendly short line. Short lines are one of the best places to keep a car, a place where it's safe. There are usually mechanics around who can help if necessary. And you want a place that's close to access to Amtrak if that's your intention. We ended up bringing the car to Morristown, New Jersey. Actually, next slide, because that's how we got it there. We ended up bringing the car up to Morristown, New Jersey. It went up from Roanoke up to northwestern New Jersey in freight service, handled both by Conrail and Norfolk Southern at the time. And that's the lounge The picture makes it look worse than it was. It was in fairly good shape. So we brought it up to Morristown. Kevin rode it home. Back then, it was a lot easier to ride in freight service. And most people, when we were buying cars back in the 80s and early 90s, were able to ride their own cars in the move to home shop, or at least have a rider that they trusted riding it. In this case, actually, Kevin ended up riding the caboose for some of the trip. There were some issues with the lock and a few other things. When he first took possession of the car, the key broke off in the lock. Fortunately, the Norfolk Southern people whose train he was on, particularly the folks in the caboose, yeah, they had him for a little while back then, were very helpful and cool people to get to know. The car itself, when we bought it, had last been in use as a test car. It went from diner to business car to a second generation of business car, and then Norfolk and Western had it in its research shop, basically. The car would go out on trains and for use in testing components of freight trains. The room that we called the parlor, when we first looked at it, in fact, looking at it and looking at weird things, had a 1970s generation computer set up in it. Use your imagination. The parlor was 6x8 at best, with a raised floor for all the cabling to go underneath. Also, and you can see in the top left picture of this slide, there's a panel with a grating on it toward the back end, toward the near end of the car. The generator was in that room on board. So you had this computer room on one side of the dining room and the generator on the other side of the dining room. The rest of it was a standard business car, two staterooms, nice lounge, which is what we saw when we looked at it. The car had been in use recently when we looked at it. They took almost all the personal stuff off. We opened the really nice refrigerators and freezers and found a few frozen dinners when we looked at it in Roanoke. But that 1970s generation computer needed a lot of attention, and it needed to make sure the power was operating well. And we think that's why the generator was actually on board the car. We left it there for a number of years. Eventually, we bought a new generator, which we did put underneath and turned that space back into crew quarters. But NNW had done a really good job with it. And so even when you were in the next room in the dining room, the generator was no louder being next to you than it would have been if it was in the car underneath. That car had something like 6 inches of insulation surrounding every wall in that generator room. And it was sound deadening, and they did a good job. I have to give them credit for what they did.
So is the car now still in New Jersey?
No. We'll get there. But what did we do with the car? And I started that. Our intention was to run a car and run trips, kind of like running the Dover Harbor. We wanted to give people a feel for what it felt like to ride a private car. Some people knew what a private car was. Occasionally people would see them on trains, at least back then. And everyone thought, oh, you know, you own a private car, you've got tons of money, which we didn't, by the way. We had good paying jobs, but none of us are wealthy, to say the least. So our goal was to run trips and let people have a small piece of this luxury. And to see small or large parts of the country doing it. You can't see the country from an airplane. You can say you've been there, but you can't see it. On a train, you get to see it all the way. And so we offered mostly weekend trips out of New York. And yes, pre-internet, pre-graphics programs on your computer, we made up flyers. This is how we advertise. Those are literal cut and paste for those of you who have never done anything like it and now just cut and paste on your computer. That's where the phrase comes from. These are paste ups for our first flyers. And I made good friends with a printer in the area. So we, you know, got them done at the last minute when we needed. We showed the car off whenever we could. The car was in our possession only a few months. The first time it was exhibited at the Hoboken Transportation Festival in Hoboken, New Jersey. We opened the car up for the day, had our flyers out, a few trips even planned, talked a lot all day long, and I think we counted a couple thousand people going through the car. It's always interesting meeting rail fans. Most of them were not rail fans. I met a few rail fans who thought they knew more about the car than I did. That was always amusing. But those two pictures were taken in Hoboken, which normally is just New Jersey Transit. So a lot of the people had seen advertising for the Hoboken Transit Festival, but they were daily commuters on New Jersey Transit. And here they were looking at our car, and I believe that's the mountain view in the bottom picture from a later couple of years later when we were there again. I think we did 5 or 6 of the Hoboken shows. Again, it was very accessible from the Morristown and Erie. We just went across the state. They took us. One of the few cab rides I ever had, by the way, was going back from Hoboken back to Morristown.
So if we just back up just a little bit in the story, when you think about owning a car, and you bought the Blue Ridge in the late 80s, and you paid a bit of money for it by an auction, right? You were bidding against other people, unknown. But the railroad was holding the keys in terms of how do you make that transfer and what the price point was.
In fact, they did. In general, I see the post from someone about how much does a private car typically cost. Then and now, private cars have a huge price range. You can buy a car for probably less than your automobile. You can easily buy a car for less than your automobile, unless you have a really cheap automobile. And you can pay $1 million for a car. And that was true then as it is now. Blue Ridge, public knowledge that we put out is it cost us 6 figures. Yes, Norfolk Southern literally was holding the keys. That was an interesting auction. They knew they had good cars. They were selling them because they were surplus. It was only a few years after NNW and Southern merged. This test car and the other cars that were for sale were essentially duplicates. When you merge a business, there are advantages of scale. To have those advantages, you have to get rid of the duplicates, no matter how good they are. And that's what they were doing. So they knew they had good equipment. And initially, in fact, none of the bids, I don't think for any of the cars at the auction, certainly not the ones we were interested in, went for the numbers that they wanted to see. So there was some negotiation, some pressure, because these were open bidding, as public as they could be made then, pre-internet. And they didn't like the numbers. Well, what are you going to do when you don't like the numbers? Try again? That's not going to get you anything better, right? And that's sort of, they got some pressure from us and other buyers, I assume, too. And eventually, within, I think, a few months, we came to an agreement, a little bit more. I don't think they were happy with the price. They were not unhappy with the sale. If you notice in a lot of these pictures, the car, as we kept it, retained Norfolk Southern, retained the railroad's name on it. That is very unusual, I came to find later. Most railroads, it will be in the contract if they sold a car that their name had to come off of it. So I guess they weren't too unhappy with what we did, or they probably would have come calling. So, oh, about price of car. Okay, here's another car. This is an example of a car that we bought for under $10,000 back in the late 1980s also. It was located in Wisconsin. And so Kevin was very happy to go home and ride that one back to the East Coast. This one, the owner who had it, shall we say he needed some cash. And he sold it pretty cheap, but it wasn't worth a whole lot more than $7,000 that we paid for it or thereabouts. It was a Milwaukee Road Tip Top Tavern Lounge. It was a really cool car. In the center of the car, it had a bar with a very small, kind of a cafe kitchen, smaller than Dover Harbor's. But the bar was a quarter round with a real, the only thing left of this car now, by the way, is the leather mural that was behind the bar. The car is gone. It had a lot of its parts. You can see some of it stacked up there in some of those pictures. The floor plan of this car was really cool because it was a lounge. It had curved banquet, curved buffet seating and curved tables in it originally. It was Milwaukee Road built. They had some really skilled carpenters on their staff. You can see some of the wood panels. That lower left, there's a wood panel about in the middle of that picture. That is actually a panel that was adjacent to the windows, and they were adjacent to all the windows. That's not plywood. It's a nice piece of wood that they had crafted to go on their walls. The windows are not all square, as you can see. Milwaukee Road did things a little differently, but they did them well also. Sadly, it was a car that we could not get up to operating on Amtrak. So, but that's kind of the range. Yeah, you can pay a little bit for a car. You'll put a lot of work into it. Somewhere in between is a sleeper. This is a sleeper of the Imperial Sands. Sleepers tend not to be real expensive. They are a lot of work to own. Most people know it. They're also not sexy cars like lounges and business cars. You know, it's just a sleeper. It holds a lot of people. But if you're going to do cross-country trips, which we did, they are very useful. The Imperial Sands sleeps 22 people, which is why we became part owners of this car along with Don Smith, and we ran it along with Blue Ridge on at least one long trip a year. Although most of our trips were out of New York on the East Coast, we would go to an Apricot convention most years. Those were invariably multi-day trips, the longest being to British Columbia. That was about 14 days. For many people, that was a trip of a lifetime. For my son, that was the trip he pretty much learned to walk on a railroad car. Can't say how much he remembers. I don't know if he wants to say. But he walked up and down the aisle of the Imperial Sands. But yeah, that was about a two-week trip. We also took Imperial Sands and Blue Ridge to San Diego, to Galveston, Sacramento, along with two other cars. The opening picture of this presentation was Blue Ridge and three other cars that we were operating going cross country to Sacramento for the convention there. There were two sleepers in that group, a dome and a business car.
So now we've established that you guys have owned many cars.
We have.
And we're focused on now, what are the challenges of owning a fleet?
The challenges of owning a fleet, like anything, it's like herding cats. They can't move on their own, but man, keeping up with them. In fact, the challenges of owning a fleet a lot have to do with the challenges of running a business. The Classic Rail Cars was a second business for all of us. We all had full-time jobs of one sort or another. My job at the patent office, I was a patent examiner at the time. And then and now we have very flexible hours and days, and I was able to take long weekends. I worked 10-hour days. to be able to go on weekend trips for 3-day weekends, which meant going up to New York. It meant coming back from New York in coach service occasionally, and then showing up at work Monday morning because I'd come back in coach service overnight. But we all fitted in. We were young and crazy. In fact, to the best of our knowledge, we were the youngest car owners then, and I don't think anyone has beaten us since as a group. And it was nice to have all that energy back then. But as these pictures show, some of those challenges also involve family and balancing everything in your life. But balancing a fleet of cars means running a business. I was often on the phone at night after work with clients and passengers. We were one of the first companies running private cars to have a website, which is why we have classicrail.com still out there. We don't use it for much. It was very early. We were ahead of our time, and we pretty much stopped running Blue Ridge and public trips by time things like reservations online became a thing to do. I kind of regret that. It might have helped at least some of those challenges. But it's a unique business, and I think the telephone is still very important. Contacting individuals and having them talk with you and be comfortable with riding a car, something this unique, that they're not going to get stranded somewhere, that we're not going to steal their money even. Personal contact is very important, so it's not just the technical. Dealing with Amtrak over the years has been a challenge. They keep changing the rules. If you want to buy a private car, be careful. They will keep changing the rules. When we first bought our cars, head-end power was not required. That generator on Blue Ridge was very important. Shortly afterwards, and we kind of saw it coming, but shortly afterwards, they started requiring head-end power. Putting head-end power on Blue Ridge, a 1914 car with heavyweight trucks and not a lot of space to run cables under it, was quite a challenge. If anyone wants to go look at Blue Ridge, I don't have a picture of it, sadly, but we have a custom-made conduit over the trucks to get the cable over the trucks and protect the cabling over the wheels. Standard conduit is round. That wouldn't fit under our car. We had a mechanic and Amtrak approval from their mechanics to run a rectangular shape so that the cables lined up and were fit in there, had enough space so they could stay cool and not overheat and get protected. Because it was the only choice that was available. These were things that we had to keep doing. They've changed rules on which trains you can run on, things like that. So let's go to some fun stuff. Yes, one of the fun things about running and riding private cars are the people you meet. Some of them famous, and these are my two examples of different ends of the political spectrum or social spectrum, take your pick. The Rolling Stones got in touch with us long way around, back when they were releasing an album called Steel Wheels. It's a bit of a double meaning. A steel wheel is the platter that a DJ uses. Of course, we all know the other meaning. And in fact, Mick Jagger knows both meanings. Mick Jagger is a bit of a rail fan, I have found. And he went to his press people and said, I want to arrive at this press conference off the platform of a car. And they all said, a caboose? We can get you a caboose. And he probably rolled his eyes because he knew better. He wanted a business car. Back then, you couldn't just, find a business car online. He eventually found the person Apropos had one person, Larry Haynes, who was sort of the main conduit for steering potential clients to car owners. And we'd had the car a few years and gotten to know Larry. Larry knew we were young and crazy. By the time he got the call from the Rolling Stones press people, there were less than 10 days before this press conference. Amtrak refuses then and refuses now and then to run a private car on less than 10 days notice. Our car was up in New Jersey. They wanted to do their press conference in Grand Central Terminal. Larry put this all together and said, well, these crazy kids are the only ones who could make this run. And I came home after a birthday dinner to find a very strange message on my answering machine. Because Larry said he had these weird clients and he didn't know quite what to do with them, but he thought they were a rock band and maybe we should give them a call. Larry at the time was about 80. So the fact that he just like, oh, they're a rock band, didn't surprise me. Eventually, we convinced him that, yes, these were clients that we'd like to have and anyone should. And we even did try to work with Amtrak briefly. Didn't work. The car went from Morristown up north and around and down the Hudson River. It went the long way in freight service. It took most of those 10 days. I think it took 3 or 4 days to get there. But we did do it. The guys boarded the car in the morning. They were only on board for the morning. They were a lot of fun. I think the coolest person in that group, by the way, personally, was my chat, longer than a chat, that I had with Mick's security guy. Fascinating man. You never know who you're going to meet. And Oliver North, that was a... Army Navy football game. That's what we ran for him. I forgot. Great gentleman. He gave us a copy of his autographed book and signed pictures for us. He was an awesome client, kind of client anyone would want.
So when you in his picture, it looks like you and Kevin and your other partner were the stewards with.
We did crew that trip. When we operated the trains, it was usually Ken and I on board. And we often did the steward's job, especially in the early years. We did all the work. We had a chef in the kitchen, but we served and handled the passengers. We each had a jumpsuit on board in case we had to make a quick change and do something mechanical. And occasionally, I guess I'm wearing a skirt there, and occasionally I'd slip a jumpsuit over and push the skirt up to my waist.
Uh-huh. So your engineering background for both you and your husband came in very handy.
Well, yeah. For me, engineering was originally more theoretical than practical, but fortunately that theory gave me the ability to learn everything. When I first started, somebody, I think it might have been Ken, did tell me that I could learn everything about the car or I could learn about air brakes. Don't try both. And to this day, I'm not all that good with air brakes.
We have a political question in the chat. It's about, was the Oliver North trip before or after Iran-Contra?
I believe it was after.
Okay.
Or during?
Okay.
Good question, because I don't remember the years.
It was after.
But besides the famous people, I think I had more fun with our friends who like to ride, our frequent passengers. Since this is the DCNRHS, that is Ken Brooks on the top picture. That is how I met Ken, even before I got active or knew much about the chapter. He signed up for many of our trips. He rode some long trips with us, mostly, I think. Great guy. The left picture is Dick Forrest, who was our most frequent passenger. Also did a little bit of legal work for us. Miss him too. And the picture on the right is John Keel. John, I got to know through Apricot. He was the photographer, main photographer and editor for Private Varnish magazine. It was through his inspiration that that article you read, Anne, was put in, was written and then put in the magazine. One of the things we used to do at Apricot conventions, when everyone else shut down for the night, we'd put a sign out that we're open and partying. And like most cars, we had an open bar. And since it was a convention and we weren't going anywhere, everyone was free to drink. Stories, information, etc., flowed fast and furious. And John came in quite often. I don't believe he was a drinker, but he was good with stories. And he convinced us to write our story. And that's how it ended up in the magazine.
And it's a great story if you haven't read it, everyone. We'll put a link to it in the timetable so you'll all get a chance to enjoy it.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Can we go on to the next? We're okay. All fascinated to know where it is now.
Where is it now, as you ask? Yes, that picture is not a bad picture. The car turned blue. For the time that we were actively running it on individual trips, we left it in Tuscan red. The color and its name, Blue Ridge, was an honor to where the car had come from. Anyway, it went to Tennessee for their bicentennial of statehood. And they used the car for about 9 months and they painted it L&N blue. And that's the color it is still now. The Blue Ridge is now indeed blue. Just a coincidence. That picture was taken in fir outside of Alamosa, Colorado. One of the few pictures I have of Wren. actually, I didn't have that picture. My son took that one. But the car, and that is where the car is now. It is out in Colorado. It ran a little bit out of Alamosa for a number of years. And unless Ken wants to unmute himself, I see he's here, and chime in, I'll leave it at that. But we have not run on Amtrak in quite a few years. After being one of the most active cars on Amtrak for a bit over 10 years, we decided to pass the baton. We were this close to being burned out anyway. And we've all moved on to a lot of other things. We've kept the cars. They're available for running. They're available for lease. They're available for sale. Even when we were running our cars, they were available for sale. Our attitude was always, for the right price, sure, we'll sell it and buy another one.
It's not really in mothball. It's in waiting for the next charter.
That is correct. That's a good description. It is in waiting for its next charter, and everything's been in waiting for the last year.
Yes.
So we call the time out, and we'll see what happens.
So would you run it now in freight service?
It's become very difficult to run in freight service. It can be moved in freight service to a new owner, to a new location. Its best use still is running on Amtrak, if Amtrak will allow, and apparently Amtrak is allowing private cars again. Dover Harbor's running. I'm scheduled to go on a trip on another car in August. So there were some really low times when I thought for a while two or three years ago that Amtrak was going to stop. But things keep changing, and I think the outlook is actually fairly good again. I sure hope so.
We all do.
Mechanically, Blue Ridge has some really awesome trucks. That car rides very well at high speeds. Those are outside swing hanger trucks. They came from, Norfolk and Western bought Penn Central 1 for the trucks, put them under this car. And it is an awesome ride. I had an Amtrak special movements person tell me when we were running the car that if any car were to be allowed to be put on the superliner on the Metroliners at 125, it would be our car. Now, none have ever done that with good reason. Well, back then they were guaranteeing the timely performance of the Metro liners, so they wouldn't do that. We had an engineer tell us he was above 120 with our car on the train one time. I won't say where or when.
Do you attribute that to its service as a testing car or to its service as a business car?
I think they probably put the trucks on it so that it could do justice as a testing car and be a stable platform. Also, the staff that was on board, standard business cars, you know, they'll ride for a few hours and stop for the night or whatever. The folks who were on board as the crew on the test car were on like for days on end. Blue Ridge had 400 gallons of water. Imperial Sands as a sleeper only had 200 gallons of water on it. When Blue Ridge was out on the road as a test car, they weren't pulling into stations where they could water it. So it had a lot of things like that on it that were special. And I suspect that's why they got the good trucks for it. I don't know how they knew they would work so well. Matching trucks and the body of a car is a bit of an art. I've been on other cars with outside swing hanger trucks that should have ridden well and didn't. I don't know if they got lucky or they had really good engineers.
So the big question we all have.
The big question, would we do it again?
Yeah, here you've been a car owner for 30 plus years.
Please don't count.
Okay, for a few decades.
but I chose these pictures for this slide for a reason. Would we do it again? Look at all those smiles. Yes, we would do it again. And I have a short video. It's about 7 minutes that was made for us in 1988 or 9, I forget now. This video was shot on a trip from New York to DC and back.
So that was a terrific, a sumptuous meal, a lovely, smooth ride, and good friends.
And in fact, I let that keep running for some of the friends. I wanted to give credit to Mark Balkin and Mark One Video, who made it for us. Mark's been gone about 10 years, I found out only recently. But he also rode with us. For old readers of Trains magazines and all, some may recognize Mark One Video. He did a lot of railroad videos back then. Another people connection, the person who often worked on our cart, who you saw with the step box in Union Station, was John Franz, an old friend of Ken's and mine. John was an unofficial owner of the car. He worked most of our trips also. The name Franz may ring a bell to readers of the Washington Post. His nephew writes most of the railroad-related travel articles that end up in the Washington Post, Justin Franz. So you never know who you're going to meet, when and where, especially on a train. People are more likely to talk to you.
Well, this has been a terrific, terrific glimpse into private car ownership, and I want to thank you very much.
You're welcome.
We don't have any more questions in the chat.
Oh, gosh, I should have said something. I was hoping people would come up with questions while they were watching the film. Are there any more questions? I'll even take them orally if someone wants to unmute themselves carefully.
Was your car on the last run of the Lake Jar Limited out of Grand Central?
Our car was the last private car out of Grand Central.
Okay, I thought so. I rode with you on that train.
Oh, gosh. And I can't remember the car we ran along with. But we were at the tail. We had a very nice end of the train when Amtrak left Grand Central. Yes.
Yes, that was a historic trip.
Yes, it was.
We were able to borrow the carpet used for the 20th Century Limited for that.
Thank you for pointing that out. Yes, we did. Another bunch of people we made friends with. Actually, I was a member of the New York City chapter of the NRHS at the time also. I believe that carpet was theirs. We
know
also
that you
operated with the Dover Harbor, and I'd like to thank all the folks, especially Kevin Tankersley, for when we worked with the Dover. Unfortunately, I didn't have any pictures of Blue Ridge and Dover Harbor together.
Oh, that's unfortunate.
I'm sorry, Ann.
Well, Ken is on the line, and you know, as a co-partner with you on this, maybe, Ken, do you want to add anything to Renee's remarks?
I think she's done a great job, covered it all. I was mostly here in case there were questions that she wanted to help fielding or needed somebody to pick on. I would tell you that this wasn't a matter of Ken getting an idea and people going, oh yeah, we'll do it. Renee was every bit as active in finding, buying, running, and suffering with the cars as I was. And she's done a great job of outlining what it's all about. Kind of like, gee, maybe we need to get going again.
Well, 2022 is coming on and we're all ready to get on the rails.
There you go.
Sounds good. Yeah, I'd like to get on the rails again. And if Amtrak's willing, maybe we will.
Well, thanks very much, Renee and Ken, and all of you for being here tonight and joining us for this really insightful program. And if you missed any of our programs, they're available on the DCNRH YouTube channel. And we've had a terrific set of presentations, and we hope that you'll come by and check out some of your favorites and even pick up some that you may not have seen that you missed. And we want to close by thank you for attending this session and thank Renee and Ken for their contributions to making this a wonderful evening. And also thanking Gary Goldsmith and Jim Perry for being my sidekicks in making logistics of this meeting happen. So with that, we'll say good night and have a wonderful evening, everybody.